Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to today's webinar, Not Quite a SNAP, Recommendations for Improving the Supplemental Nutrition Assistance Program for Latinos. As you know, we'll be referring to Supplemental Nutrition Assistance Programs as SNAP. My name is Delia Pompa, Senior Vice President for Programs at NCLR, and I'll be serving as today's moderator. We're really excited to share with you our most recent work supported by the ConAgra Foods Foundation. Our work is set out to improve access to the consumer experience of Latinos in the SNAP program. This research builds on a body of work we have completed in the past to better understand the issues of hunger and food insecurity within our community. If you haven't had the opportunity, we encourage you to take a look at our Comer Bien and Sin Provecho reports. They're available on our website. But before we begin, there are a few housekeeping items to keep in mind. And you know, with webinars, there's lots of things we have to do differently than we might not have to do if this were an in-person session. But first of all, to avoid any background noise, all phone lines except those of the presenters have been muted. We will be taking questions at the end of the presentation. Since your phone line is muted, however, please use the chat function to type in your questions or comments. You may have at any time during the presentation, and we're going to keep tabs on those. We're going to do the best we can to get as many questions as we can during the time we have remaining. But again, type in those questions at any time during the presentations. Finally, we'll be recording this webinar, and we'll make the recording and presentation available on our website within the next couple of weeks. For those of you who joined us today, we will send you an email letting you know when the recording and presentation has been posted. Now, getting to the meat of our presentation, I'd like to take a few minutes to introduce today's speakers. First, we're going to have Ellen Vollinger, who's Legal Director for the Food Research and Action Center, more commonly known as FRAC. She's responsible for directing FRAC's advocacy on behalf of SNAP. Ellen has led FRAC's efforts to bolster SNAP to serve working families, legal immigrants, and victims of disaster. Next will be Patricia Foxen, who's the Deputy Director of Research at NCLR. She's responsible for the development and implementation of NCLR's agenda for policy-oriented research across multiple issue areas, particularly around Latino children and youth, race and ethnicity, civil rights, and social integration. Next on the lineup, we'll have Carla Plaza, who's a consultant for NCLR. She works for NCLR's Office of Research and Advocacy and Legislation on childhood nutrition and obesity issues. And finally, tying this all up will be Teresa Palacios, who's the Executive Director of the Eastmont Community Center located in East Los Angeles. In 2012, Teresa was awarded the Imagen Foundation Latina Leaders Award based on her leadership and volunteer service in East LA. Eastmont Community Center is one of two California-based NCLR affiliates involved with this project. So now, let's go to Ellen.
Thank you so much, and I appreciate the opportunity to join you, and very excited about the research that National Council of Raza is unveiling today. Next slide. My part of the presentation is really to give you an overview before we get into the NCLR research and findings. First, as many of you may be too acutely aware, hunger is a very big problem in the United States. One way to think about it is that when Gallup asked households in America if there had been times in the prior 12 months when they didn't have enough money to buy food that they or their family needed, 18.9% of those surveyed said yes, that had been a problem. Next slide. We know that it's a problem that affects everybody in America, all types of populations, but it also has a disproportionate impact on the Latino population, both food security, health, and obesity. And we've given you just a few facts here that in 2012, 23.3% of Hispanic households were food insecure. That's an official government measure that the Census Bureau and the United States Department of Agriculture put out to gauge whether or not people are worried about where the next meal is coming from. That's a very significant and negative indicator. That population for Hispanics was the second highest overall food insecurity rate and was two times the food insecurity rate for white and non-Hispanic households. That same year, 27.2% of Hispanic households with children were food insecure. Again, that was higher than the overall rate. It was the second highest overall rate for population group, and it was nearly 10 percentage points higher than for the white non-Hispanic households with children. We also know from research that overweight and obesity rates are a problem for all of Americans, but disproportionately also hitting Hispanic and African American children. Next slide. So what can we do about this? One of the premier fighters of hunger, food insecurity, poverty, and a promoter of health is the Supplemental Nutrition Assistance Program, SNAP, formerly called the Food Stamp Program. It is the nation's first line of defense against hunger. It's a national program. The United States Department of Agriculture administers it, but they do that through state governments. The federal government pays 100% of the SNAP benefits, the food benefits that go on electronic benefit transfer cards and get used in grocery outlets. The federal government shares with states the cost of administering the program. States operate within federal rules, but they do have a range of options that can increase access to the program and make it a more meaningful support for families. And later in the presentation, I think you'll be hearing from NCLR about some of the suggestions they have for states on running the most effective programs. The benefits can be very significant. The maximum SNAP benefit is $632 a month. That's for a family of four. That is still not as adequate as it would be if the government based SNAP benefits on a more adequate meal plan, and we'll talk a little bit more about that later. The average SNAP benefit, though, is a mere $4 a person a day. That's data from March of 2014. So it's an important benefit, but it's by no means overly generous, and people are really struggling and stretching their dollars. Again, they redeem their benefits with EBT cards. Food stamps, paper coupons are a thing of the past. And most of the benefits, most SNAP benefits, are redeemed at the larger retailers, supermarkets and superstores. And for the most recent fiscal year for which we have data, we know that over 80% of the benefits were redeemed at those large retailers. Next slide. Why do we care about SNAP? We care about SNAP because it's serving so many needy people. There are over 46 million people participating in SNAP right now, and we know a significant portion of them do come from the Hispanic community. 6.4 million plus are Hispanic Americans. There are slightly more Hispanic females than Hispanic males. We also know that in some households, Hispanic and otherwise, that there are a mix of citizenship status in those households. Some citizen children are living with non-citizen adults. They may or may not be inside the SNAP household unit for purposes of the SNAP program. We mention that because I think you're going to be hearing later from NCLR about some of the citizenship restrictions in SNAP that may be affecting access for the Latino community. But SNAP is a very widespread experience for people in America, and when asked by Pew Research if they'd ever received SNAP or food stamps in the past, 18% of U.S. adults said they had. It's slightly higher percentage of Hispanic adults and even higher percentage of Hispanic female adults. 31% of Hispanic female adults said that at one point they have received SNAP. The next slide. And we care about SNAP because we know that the benefits can be very significant. It reduces hunger and food insecurity. The program is structured so that when unemployment and economic need is greater, SNAP is there to respond and be a counter-cyclical force. We know that it's very targeted. It's targeted to the people who are the neediest. Most of the benefits go to people who are below the poverty line. And they go to groups of people who particularly are vulnerable, households with seniors, people with disabilities, and children. And in fact, 47% of all recipients are kids. And finally, it's a program that's helping working families as well as people who are looking for jobs. And 42% of participants reside in households that do have earnings. Next slide. Again, this is a program that kicks in when the economy is worse, and it's one of its strengths is that economic strength. It stimulates the economy. Each dollar of federal SNAP benefits produces economic activity in a locality because those benefits are spent in retail settings, retailers hire their store clerks, they hire people who stock their shelves, there are truckers who bring the food in, and of course further on the food chain, there's an economic benefit to farmers. So it's an important role. And of course, the very important nutrition impacts of SNAP. We know from research that it does improve nutrient availability, it helps child health, it may reduce obesity. And we've given you a link to a study with many more sites to the findings in case you want to follow up on that. Next slide. So even with its strengths, however, there are two major gaps that we worry about in SNAP and whether or not it's there to help as many people as needed. The first is a gap in participation. First of all, the program is not open to everyone. It's not even open to everyone who's needy. There are some populations who are restricted from being able to access the benefits even though they have very low incomes. I'm thinking particularly of non-citizens who face some bars to being able to participate in the program. There also are some roadblocks to certain jobless adults without children being able to access the program. So it's a program that is targeted, but it doesn't target everyone who's needy. But even within the groups that are eligible, there are many eligible people that are just missing out on benefits. They're eligible for SNAP, but they're just not getting them. And disproportionately, the people who are missing out the most are the elderly, their citizen children living with non-citizen adults, and their non-citizens. Those are missing out in quite significant ways. A recent study that the Economic Research Service did for USDA was to look at one state, Texas, and there they found a big gap in participation based on whether or not the household was an isolated Spanish-speaking household. Next slide. The other major gap in the ability for SNAP to really help the people who need it is that the benefits are low. There is a study out which will go through for you why some of these benefit levels are so low. One of the major ones is that the government pegs the cost of SNAP and the cost of those benefits to what it costs to purchase the lowest possible meal plan that the government has. And with that, I think we'll be turning to La Raza. In the meantime, we've given you a slide, next slide, that that does provide information that you can get more broadly about FRAC. We work with anti-hunger groups across the country. There are many resources for you to align with the anti-hunger community and going forward. There's lots of information on the FRAC website. Again, I'm looking forward to getting more into the meat of the NCLR research and their recommendations and turn it over to them right now. Thank you.
Helen, thanks for that really important context. And now we will get into the NCLR research that you've all been waiting to hear about. We're going to hear from Patricia Foxen.
Great. Thank you so much, Delia. I'm really excited to share with you some of the findings from this research that we conducted last spring with Latino SNAP recipients in Southern California. As Delia mentioned, this project, which we named Building Bridges to SNAP for Latino Families, is an extension of the work that our health policy and research teams have been doing on the nutritional health and well-being of Latino families. The project we're talking about today was a follow-up to Comer Bien, a story collection project that we conducted to tell the stories of Latino families in four states around their experiences with nutrition and food insecurity. One of the things that surfaced throughout Comer Bien was Latino families' experiences with some barriers to the SNAP program. A number of folks that we talked that we spoke with had talked about how SNAP served to alleviate hunger and food insecurity, but also they alluded to various issues and areas of confusion. So we felt this deserved more specific exploration. Next slide. So the main objectives of our current research are the following: to delve deeper into Latino experiences in receiving and renewing SNAP, to document common barriers that Latinos experience under SNAP, and to identify mechanisms to facilitate access to food assistance by exploring awareness of, enrollment, and retention in programs. So as we'll see in a second, the project included a focus group and story collection component. But before I talk about methods, I'll give you a quick sense of the context and communities in which we decided to do this research. There are a few reasons why we selected California as the site for the research. California was the largest, has the largest Latino population, and is also a state where the need for food assistance is very high. The poverty rate all around is about 25%, yet it has a low SNAP participation rate. The participation rate of eligible Latinos is 56% nationwide, which is already low, and California is just 43%. So we thought that this would be a good area to tease out some of the main challenges of the program. We decided to work in two somewhat contrasting geographic areas where NCLR has affiliates who have a strong connection to the community and who assisted us in organizing and recruiting participants for the project. In East LA, we worked with Eastmont Community Center, as you heard, and we'll be hearing more from Teresa a bit later. And in Imperial Valley, a border area not far from Mexicali, we worked with our affiliate Clínicas de Salud del Pueblo. Imperial Valley is a set of interconnected towns along the border, including El Centro and Brawley, where we did the research. This area has an economy based in agriculture, and it's extremely poor. Environmental issues like pesticides, et cetera, make this one of the most polluted regions in the state, which has major implications for the health of residents and workers. Transportation to just about anywhere, jobs, medical resources, social services, and even grocery stores, is difficult and costly given the vast spaces between communities and lack of public transport. Many of the people we spoke with worked in the fields and followed the harvests or in construction. The area was particularly hard hit by the recession. A significant number of folks that we spoke with had lost jobs and homes during that time and were still struggling to get back on track. By contrast, East LA is obviously a more urban setting filled with bustling neighborhoods. Here, rents are high, violence is more common, and the competition for jobs is fierce. Though families may not have to worry about lack of public transportation as much as they do in border town, although anybody who's been in LA knows that transportation is an issue there, accessing fresh produce can produce a challenge due to the lack of availability and affordability in stores closest to Latino communities. Next slide, please. So we essentially had two sub-projects. One was a story collection project where we spoke with individuals about their personal experiences with SNAP in order to elevate voices that don't often get heard and hear about how food assistance policies affect Latino families at a very human level. The other sub-project, which is the one we're discussing now, is based on four focus groups conducted in both sites with both current SNAP users and people who had been on SNAP but had gotten off in the past 6 months. So we wanted to hear from people who could talk directly about their current experiences, but also from those who were no longer recipients. The goal of the focus groups was to understand some of the main themes around awareness, enrollment, and retention in the SNAP program, as well as questions about quantity and quality of nutrition facilitated by SNAP, and more general questions such as how community infrastructure affects nutrition. We spoke with Latino parents, so all respondents had children, and with both immigrants and non-immigrants. Three of the focus groups were facilitated in Spanish and one in English. We tried to get at acculturation issues by dividing the groups in this way, though obviously language isn't a perfect indicator of acculturation. As I mentioned, our affiliates recruited focus group participants, but we also made sure to include participants who were not closely connected to the programs and services of our affiliates so as to make sure we were also speaking with people outside of those networks. So of course, the focus groups were anonymous, so we can't show you any visuals, but I can give you a sense of a couple of the people we spoke with for our story collection project who agreed to be photographed. So you can read the quote yourself, but Maria is the wife of a farm worker who made just over the limit for SNAP eligibility. However, her family struggled greatly with skyrocketing health costs resulting from their daughter's significant medical problems. Their daughter had lupus. There's a lot of children with very serious health problems in this area, and a lot of families, in addition to struggling with poverty, are struggling with these issues. Jesse, who you can see there, is a construction worker who lost his job during the recession and became homeless. He also has some addiction problems and now has gotten back on track, and he talked to us about how SNAP really helped him get out of a dark place. Next slide, please. So I'll quickly go through some of the main themes that came out of the focus groups. The first theme is that Latino families found the program vital. Most participants sought assistance through SNAP after a significant unpredictable life event, such as the sudden death of a spouse, medical, family emergency, or loss of a job, an event that severely restricted their ability to support themselves. Participants noted that the program was able to sustain them through difficult times and expressed gratitude for the assistance and spoke openly about how SNAP helped them survive. So this echoes a lot of research that has shown this. I wanted to include some direct quotes in all these findings. I won't be reading them out, but you can take a look to get a sense of some of the words that people were using. Next slide, please. The second finding is that despite great effort, families struggled to make benefits last through the month. So we know that the average SNAP recipient in the U.S. receives $133 a month, or at least that was the case in 2012, or $1.78 per meal. So our focus group participants often shared experiences of attempting to stretch SNAP benefits and frequently running out of benefits and having to make adjustments in eating well before the end of the month. So we can see here in the quotes some examples of the strategies that people used. For those who live in the border towns where distances and gas are issues, some created carpool to minimize transportation costs when they received their food stamps. Next slide, please. A third theme was that the design features of the SNAP program made continuous participation difficult. The income reporting structure was reportedly extremely problematic for participants whose income levels changed frequently. Fluctuating income is often the case for Latinos working in certain sectors like agriculture, construction, and minimum wage jobs most impacted by the recession. Because benefits are determined through income reporting at specific points in time, a spike in income around the time of reporting can trigger a sudden drop in benefits. Similarly, SNAP benefits often get cut just when a family is getting back on their feet, limiting the program's impact. Finally, while there is some flexibility, many reported that income benefit calculations do not consistently take into account the costs of other household expenses, like medical, transportation, energy, and other debts or costs that severely limit what types of food and how much food families can buy. A fourth theme was that myths about the SNAP program are prevalent in the Latino community and discourage participation. So the focus group participants surfaced several myths that continue to plague the program. For instance, they reported claims such as the following. One, applying for SNAP would affect the immigration status of parents, including the chance of participants obtaining residency or citizenship. That was often described as something that was being circulated in the community. Participants and their children could be charged for the benefits received and have to repay the government later. Many people expressed that they had heard that fear in the community. And third, that food stamps are supported by individual contributions and not the government, and therefore would penalize others unfairly. So for example, you can see in that last quote, somebody said, is it true that food stamps are paid for by farm workers' contributions? Where does the food stamp money come from? Next slide. A fifth finding was that, and this one came across very, very strongly, and I know it's been written about by other researchers, many participants experienced poor customer service and reported negative experiences with caseworkers. A number of participants did report having very good experiences with caseworkers, but those were fewer, and many shared specific stories of bad interactions with their caseworkers, from failure to be fully informed about documents needed to complete the process, the enrollment process, to experiences of abusive treatment. Participants felt that they were unable to ask questions either in person or over the phone about enrollment processes and eligibility requirements, often due to language barriers or the inaccessibility of caseworkers. They repeatedly mentioned the difficulty in getting caseworkers to respond to the phones or messages in order to get questions answered about their applications or changes in benefits, et cetera. Some focus group participants felt disrespected by caseworkers, including those who actually could communicate in Spanish but sometimes chose not to. Participants were especially frustrated with disregard caseworkers had for the amount of time, cost, and effort involved with having to return to local SNAP agencies due to incorrect guidance regarding documentation requirements provided by caseworkers. Negative incidents with caseworkers frequently raised the level of frustration with participants and with participation in the program, often delayed benefits received, and sometimes increased the burden of enrolling and ongoing participation in SNAP. And I'll be wrapping up with our final theme, which was, again, something that came through very clearly in all the focus groups. The perceived negative stigma of being a SNAP recipient leads potentially eligible Latinos to stop participating in SNAP once their financial situation stabilized. So I'll just explain that quickly. The focus group participants expressed a strong desire to be self-reliant and self-sufficient. As we mentioned, many reportedly use the program more as an emergency support than an ongoing resource. At the same time, a theme that was brought up in all groups was the existence of fraudulent SNAP users, whose behaviors influence the public image of all SNAP users, including the majority who are participating in the program responsibly. Focus group participants wanted to make clear that they sought to avoid the negative stigma associated in public discourse with SNAP users, especially immigrants and Latinos. Several focus group participants reported having left the program as soon as they could, even if they were still potentially eligible for food stamps. So that's it for the research.
Thank you. Thank you, Patricia. Before I turn this over to Carla, I just want to remind you that you can type in your questions or comments at any time. We'll make note of them, and we will pose them after all the speakers present. And I believe you have the instructions for typing those in. If not, we'll give them to you later in the presentation. So right now, I want to turn this over to Carla Plaza, who has more information on NCLR's research.
Great. Thanks, Celia. So as mentioned by Alan, both the federal government and states jointly administer SNAP. With this in mind, we developed program and policy recommendations for the administration and Congress to consider, as well as state program administrators. These recommendations are grounded on insights and comments made by focus group participants that Patricia just shared with you. Our purpose for developing these recommendations is to help improve the participation rate among eligible Latinos given the current gap that exists. Our first recommendation is the need to restore full and equal access to the program for all lawfully present legal immigrants. In 1996, a law was enacted that complicated the enrollment process for many immigrant families. Currently, the law prohibits most lawfully present adults from enrolling in the SNAP program unless they have been living in the country for 5 years. NCLR believes that the eligibility rules regarding immigration status could be simplified if the federal government would restore full and equal access to the program for all lawfully present legal immigrants. Taking this step will not only restore equity for lawfully present immigrants, but will also ensure that eligible family members, family citizen children, will participate in the program. Because of the comments you heard regarding the difficulty enrollees have in stretching their monthly SNAP allotment, we think that the federal government should improve how the SNAP benefit is calculated to better meet the needs of enrollees. In 2012, the USDA asked the Institute of Medicine and National Research Council to examine the adequacy of the SNAP enrollment. The resulting report released last year called on the USDA to consider including individual, household, and environmental factors into the definition of adequate SNAP allotment. Based on the comments made by focus group participants, NCLR supports these recommendations. The IOM report laid out several assumptions on how SNAP benefits are calculated, which does not factor in current real-life circumstances. For example, the report noted that the program does not account for the variability of food prices over the course of the year or across the country, the amount of time, distance, and cost it takes to purchase food, or the inadequate access to stores that sell healthier products at affordable prices, comments frequently made by focus group participants. In addition, focus group participants noted that SNAP benefit calculations do not factor in family composition, for example, the age of children and the difference in cost between feeding a teenager versus a young child, unexpected medical expenses, or fluctuations in income based on seasonal or overtime employment. This slide will walk you through the recommendations we have made to improve the calculations as well as the monthly allotments of the SNAP benefits. First, we believe that Congress should stop cutting the level of federal funding that goes towards programs and relief and put in place policy changes that further reduce benefits for children and families. Within the last 8 months, SNAP households have faced significant cuts in the monthly allotments. First, in November 2013, from the temporary 13.6% increase in SNAP allotments for nearly all participating households expired. Second, the reauthorization of the Farm Bill in February 2014, as Ellen mentioned earlier, made changes to the heat and eat provision of SNAP. Heat and eat gives states the option to provide a higher SNAP benefit allotment to SNAP households that also participate in the low-income home assistance energy program. This coordination has prevented families from having to choose whether to heat their homes versus purchasing food. However, some members of Congress believe that this coordination created a loophole for states to draw down additional federal funding and put in place a provision in the bill that required families to receive $20 in heating benefits before additional SNAP aid could kick in. We also think that the SNAP benefit should be pegged to the USDA's low-cost food plan versus the thrifty food plan. The thrifty food plan does not realistically account for the needs of a family for purchasing and preparing a healthy meal. In addition, the plan does not factor in some of the variables mentioned in the previous slide. Because determining SNAP eligibility and monthly allotments is complicated, we also recommend that the federal government provide guidance and training to ensure that calculations are being done correctly by caseworkers. We learned through our research that mistakes are made by caseworkers, such as forgetting to take allowable deductions that it would increase the monthly benefit for SNAP recipients. Furthermore, applicants are not sure how their monthly benefits are calculated and are unclear of what deductions are allowable in the program. We think that the government could invest more resources in developing materials that explain how the SNAP allotment is calculated to better inform SNAP recipients. We also recommend that the federal government remove caps on allowable deductions, particularly the shelter deduction. As mentioned previously, Latino participation in the SNAP program is lower compared to other racial groups. The misinformation that exists about the program within the community is partly to blame. These myths, as shared by Patricia, often delay or prevent folks from applying for SNAP benefits, even if they are eligible. The USDA has taken great strides to improve the participation rate of eligible Latinos in SNAP and has developed and disseminated information about the program on eligibility requirements in Spanish. However, the federal investment in outreach and education has fluctuated over time and is currently in a downward trajectory. For example, the Farm Bill eliminated the use of federal funding to support television, radio, and billboard advertising for the SNAP program. Such type of advertising, as exemplified by industry practice, allows information about a particular program or product to penetrate and reach targeted communities who may not be aware that they exist. To combat the myths that exist within the community regarding the program, it is important to continue investing in outreach and education efforts. We strongly urge the federal government to invest resources in targeted outreach and education by restoring the cuts made. Focus group participants noted the usefulness of written materials that explain process and procedures, and they thought that investments in education on benefits calculation and the recertification process could help reduce the drop-off rate among eligible Latino families. We also think that the USDA could do more to lift up best practices in Hispanic, immigrant, or non-English language outreach to help disseminate ideas across the country. In addition, we think that the agency could reestablish a robust competitive grant program to fund state outreach activities. Next slide. Participants also made comments regarding the treatment of limited English proficient families in the program. NCLR has previously conducted research in this area and has found evidence of the unequal treatment of limited English proficient individuals within the benefit application process. We recommend that public notices be developed in a language understood by the applicants and placed on applications and in offices to inform individuals of the full range of rights to language access. Additionally, we believe that civil rights compliance checks need to be conducted to identify any problems, and action should be taken immediately to address them. In these set of slides, you will note that many of the recommendations offered for state programs mirror the recommendations we identified for federal government, but with a different twist. We believe that states do not need to wait for federal action to improve their SNAP programs in order to improve the participation rate of eligible Latinos. Although we would like to see the federal government act to restore full and equal access to SNAP for all lawfully present legal immigrants, the reality is that those changes will be a long time coming given the political environment in Congress. However, states do have the option of creating state-funded programs to provide food assistance benefits to legal immigrant citizens who do not qualify for the federal program based on their immigration status. The five states noted in the slide have such programs in place in case you're interested in learning more about their program. One more. There we go. As mentioned earlier, states are given the option to coordinate their LIHEAP and SNAP programs. Many states with existing HEAT and EAT programs have decided to maintain these programs despite congressional efforts to limit this coordination. NCLR calls on all states with HEAT and EAT programs to maintain these programs so that families do not have to choose between heating their homes or putting healthy food on the table. We also think that states that do not have such a program in place should consider taking up this option. Because SNAP programs are administered by states, states also have a direct role to play in providing guidance and training to caseworkers to ensure that the SNAP benefit allotments are calculated correctly. Local and state agencies should consider providing annual training for caseworkers to ensure that all eligible deductions are being factored in when making SNAP determinations. We all recognize that education and outreach is critical for raising awareness. States have provided grants to nonprofit organizations that directly serve the Hispanic community to help conduct outreach and education activities. It is important to have dedicated materials and assistance that explains the rules of the program to applicants. Outreach workers, particularly trusted community members or organizations, are in a position to provide such assistance and distribute these materials to ensure that eligible Latinos are made aware of the program and to combat the myths that exist. We think that more ambitious investments should be made to bolster consumer awareness and confidence in the program. States also have a role to play in disseminating best practices in Hispanic, immigrant, or non-English language outreach. Local and state agencies could produce and disseminate in multiple languages consumer-friendly materials to help inform people about the program, as well as educate applicants on how benefits are calculated, including guidance on allowable deductions. However, there is no need to recreate the wheel if such materials exist. State programs can play a role in ensuring that local agencies or community-based organizations are made aware of the resources that have been developed by serving as a hub of information. As mentioned previously, focus group participants expressed strong frustration with the SNAP enrollment process, particularly with caseworkers. States should also invest in culturally competency training for caseworkers, particularly for those caseworkers who work in local agencies within predominant Hispanic communities. Knowing how to communicate accurate program information and interact with clients, particularly those with limited or no English proficiency, is a critical first step for ensuring a positive consumer experience during the enrollment process. Participants also outlined the need to better understand the expectations of the application process so that they could plan accordingly around their appointments and bring with them the necessary paperwork that would be required of them. We recommend that state programs consider developing a checklist that outlines the enrollment process and eligibility requirements in a culturally and linguistically appropriate manner. In addition, because interactions with caseworkers were often the make or break reason that someone received benefits, we believe that SNAP applicants should be asked to provide anonymous feedback so that supervisors can obtain information on processes and consumer interactions in order to improve this experience. And as I close, I just wanted to provide you information about some of the NCLR resources that are currently available that Delia mentioned earlier. So we've created this one slide that will provide you with the URL link to the materials that Delia highlighted in her opening remarks.
Thanks very much, Carla. We're really excited that Teresa Palacios could join us today. She's going to share her initial reactions to our presentation, and she's going to provide on-the-ground insights about how we can further improve the SNAP program for Latinos. So now, Teresa, let us hear from you.
Hi, thank you. Thank you all for such a great presentation. As a community member, as a community leader, I'm very thankful for this kind of information that's been brought to our affiliates and all those involved. But talking about my experience with the SNAP and the focus group, I want to commend Patricia and her team that came to work with us. It not only the participants learned and were educated as to how to go about applying and participating in the SNAP program, but also myself and my staff also learned about the needs that we were not covering on our side. We do provide food on our everyday services, but we were missing on that. And because of what we learned from our own community, we established a relationship with the Department of Public Social Services, known as the Welfare Agency. And we asked for one of their staff to come over to our site and provide how to fill out the forms in Spanish so that they can be more accessible to avoid lines and to avoid all those barriers that they have when they go in person to the office. So we have that now. She comes here twice a week, and she fills out the application, and if they need assistance, then she comes back. Also, we are participating also with NCLR in the Comprando Rico y Sano. And we are also having charlas where we inform our participants about the SNAP. And we're also referring most of our families. And since they don't have to go far, they can do that here at the same office. We're trying to bring more and more participants so that they get the benefits of the SNAP program. I think this is a great opportunity that all of us learn that we have a need and it's not being taken care of. And I really, as a member of this community, I appreciate what you're doing at the federal level to help us bring this more of the participation of our community in this type of program.
Thank you very much, Teresa. I just want to point out or emphasize what Teresa described earlier, a Comprando Rico y Sano program, which is one of the programmatic efforts here at NCLR where 20 NCLR affiliates are participating through their Promotoras de Salud in a program that teaches families how to shop on a budget and choose, make healthy selections. And along with teaching this information, the Promotoras are also helping enroll folks in SNAP. So we have a dual effort going on here at NCLR. So we have a number of questions. The first one that came up was for Patricia, asking, what stood out to you most about the focus groups?
Well, they were lovely focus groups. I have to say, I think the thing that stood out most to me was just the positive spirit and the real resiliency that people sort of demonstrated in the conversations that we were having. Most of these folks had gone through very tough times. As I mentioned, a lot of people had lost jobs, had lost their homes. They really, you know, they were living in poverty. Just we're going through a difficult time, and yet the things that came out mostly in the focus groups were really just how grateful they were to the SNAP program, but also the fact that they did not want to be on the SNAP program for the rest of their lives at all. And I think that for me, that last theme of the question of stigma was a really important one, because it wasn't even one that was part of the line of questioning in the focus groups, but it came out very strongly. And I think that part of the reason for that is that focus group participants wanted to make very clear that they were not takers, that they were hard workers, and whether they were immigrants or not, that they really were using or had used SNAP because they were basically forced to do so. So I think that's primarily what came out from the focus group.
This is an interesting question. Does the poor customer service also come from Spanish-speaking caseworkers, and are Spanish-speaking caseworkers compensated for their language skills? I imagine that varies from state to state, but did you find anything in this area, Patricia?
I have absolutely no idea about the compensation part of that question, but what I did find interesting, you know, this was California, and a lot of the caseworkers were Latino themselves, and as I mentioned, some of them who actually did speak Spanish would not do so with the customers, and so that was taken as being quite rude. So yeah,
thank you. Ellen, this one's for you. How can community-based organizations work to improve programs in their state?
Well, I think there are probably a couple of things. One, I'm so happy you mentioned the Promotoras model, because community groups can be on the ground and providing information, whether it's on nutritious choices or whether it's the program information to help connect people with the programs that they need to help them apply for SNAP and get through the enrollment process. And community groups can work with their state to get some funding so that they can have outreach projects that help people navigate the SNAP enrollment process. So that would be one very important way. And of course, another would be to engage in the policy advocacy. The recommendations that NCLR has laid out today, based very much on the careful research that was done, the very good focus group research, make a lot of sense. But it will take concerned people, community groups, and others to get the word to their state officials and to their federal officials about what some of those policy choices are that can make the difference between people getting enough to afford a healthy diet and going without. But community groups really, they can play both education and advocacy roles, and they're really a terrific resource.
Thanks. This question's for anybody. Can anybody give us any, did you see any promising practices or approaches that you found for working through Latino kids to reach families or the kids themselves?
Teresa, could you maybe take that question?
What we're doing right now, that we're also doing the charlas with the Comprando Rico y Sano, we're involving also the kids. So what we do is when we have, we also have food presentations and so demonstrations so that they learn how to prepare healthy foods, and it's for the family together. So now we also talk about the SNAP and how they can be able to buy this healthy foods by using their benefits from the SNAP program. So that's how we get our families involved. That's our way. And we see in our center, every day we see about 150 people. So that's how we get access. And it's, since we're based in the community, our way of communication is through word of mouth, and that's how they get to other families.
Great. Thank you very much. One comment is that seniors receiving SNAP in California are not receiving SNAP in California, or they're not eligible, but those that are, this is a confusing question, let me see if I can rephrase by reading through this. Some seniors who receive SNAP, and they believe not all do, are not receiving enough money for food. You talked, Fadla, about the recommendations for using the current laws that we have. This particular participant wants to know what we can do to change laws, or if we have any ideas about laws that should be changed so that people would receive more funding.
So as you know, we currently, or maybe you're not as aware, we currently went through a reauthorization process of the SNAP program when it was when the farm bill itself got reauthorized in February. So the window for potentially increasing benefits is probably not so open at this time, given the battle that took place in Congress as it related to this program not so long ago. So I think what we can do now is continue to keep the drumbeat going as to the importance as to why we need to improve the benefits, increase allotments for families, and just start shoring up the evidence that we need to make the case for that request for the next reauthorization period. I don't know, Ellen, you have any other thoughts to share on that question?
Generally, that's very much the case, Carla, that the best opportunity to change SNAP comes during the regular five-year reauthorization, but we do find that Congress can take things up when there's enough interest, enough political will, and so I appreciate your comment about keeping the drumbeat going, because Congress can attach changes to SNAP in other legislative vehicles when there's enough interest. So getting that drumbeat going, the awareness, would be very important. Absolutely.
Patricia, you're going to like this one. How can local partners support NCLR's advocacy efforts?
Love that. How can local partners? Well, I think Teresa and also our affiliates in Imperial Valley were great examples of that. You know, we were very much welcomed not only into the our affiliates centers, but also for the story collection portion of the project into people's homes. And they were extremely happy to hear that their voices would be heard here in Washington. And so, I mean, I think that reaching out to us, basically helping us to find those stories and to find those qualitative stories, I think a lot of what we do that's policy-based is often based on hard data and numbers, and I think that the richness of this particular project was that we really got to hear people's human stories and their own words. So yeah, just helping us find those people and setting up that kind of research is great.
There's a question about partnerships that NCLR might be developing with USDA Civil Rights Division to advocate on behalf of community members who face significant discrepancies when they're trying to apply for SNAP. We have had partnerships with USDA before in educating our affiliates and getting the word out. In particular, Patricia, I'm not aware of any specific collaboration we have with the Civil Rights Division of USDA. The question is, how can we as CBOs connect our clients to the process? As CBOs, you actually can contact the Department, the Office of Civil Rights within any of the government organizations and file complaints. So that would be the generic response I would give you. There's a question about what legislators can do at the state level to increase SNAP participation. Any ideas there?
Well, this is Ellen. One thing I would mention is that there's a great resource that the National Conference of State Legislatures has. That's ncsl.org. That's a bipartisan organization that represents the both chambers in every state across the country. And on their Hunger Partnership, they have a toolkit that they offer legislators on how they can be anti-hunger advocates, everything from legislating within their chambers, but also being community leaders, convening stakeholders who would care about hunger, helping to do the education and outreach, putting things in their newsletters. So there are a variety of roles, and even within the legislative setting, sometimes it's about passing legislation, but often legislators can play a key role in oversight, having the state agency come in and explain what they're doing. So there are a variety of opportunities for state lawmakers to make a difference, and I would just recommend that among the really good resources to point people to would be that ncsl.org toolkit on hunger.
And I also wanted to add, this is Carla, that it is important for you all at community-based organizations to collect these stories and also share it with your state legislators. I mean, we have a tendency to just talk about sharing stories with members of Congress because we're inside the Beltway here in D.C., but it equally applies to you all at the state. I mean, those stories, and that is very powerful and could essentially create champions within the hunger community in order to help raise awareness among state legislative bodies as to the reason why programs need to be improved.
Thanks. Either Patricia or Carla, there's a question about when the report will be published and released. People are eager to have it. And another caller wants to, or participant wants to know the web address for NCLR resources, if there's a specific URL to use.
So in terms of the report, we are still working on developing a more comprehensive product that will hopefully include both the policy recommendations as well as some of the findings that Patricia shared. However, in the meantime, we are planning to release a shorter version, a memo, following a briefing that we're doing on the Hill next week. So you should expect to receive not only the presentation that we shared with you today, but also the policy memo within a two-week time frame, and then hopefully soon thereafter there will be a report.
Ellen, are you aware of any materials, really good materials, that local community organizations or state agencies might already have and they're already created that are user-friendly and can share information in a more accessible way than reading regulations or big reports?
Yeah, absolutely. And I would recommend going onto the FRAC website, frac.org, in our SNAP section, because we do link to some reports. One of them is called Smart Choices and Hard Times, and it lays out, without, I think, quite the jargon, what some of these state options are. It provides links to the regulations, so if someone wants to go in and be armed with the regulations, they have that. But we do try to have things in more vernacular, easier to understand, both for our community partners, but also for legislators. No one, regardless of where they're situated, wants to wade through a lot of technical information that's not understandable. I will say there are a lot of very good resources on the USDA Food and Nutrition Service website with respect to information about SNAP and basic outreach materials in different languages. Very, very good materials. And many of the organizations we work with across the country produce their own brochures that are state-specific. Many of them operate hotlines, and we'd be happy working with Carla to put any of the folks on the webinar in touch with some of those community partners if they're looking for state-specific information.
Thank you. And I'm sorry, I forgot to
provide you the information with the URL address for NCLR resources. On your screen, you'll have a slide that shows a web page for the Healthy Foods and Healthy Families work that we've been doing here. But essentially, you just need to go to the NCLR.org homepage and look under issues for health and nutrition, and you should be able to get to that information.
While we wait for one final question that we have time for, our participant wrote in an explanation of the question about seniors. The situation is that the amount SNAP seniors receive is not enough to go through the application process. It doesn't justify them going through that entire process, apparently. So this is a concern to them, and they're wondering if there are any ways to mitigate this. And I imagine one way would be to increase the amount of benefit, and the other way would be to decrease the amount of paperwork. And again, that's probably best addressed through reauthorization, I hope, next time around.
Well, I can say, in the meantime, one of the most significant ways to boost seniors' allotments is to take into account the out-of-pocket medical costs they have. The SNAP program is designed to take into account medical costs for seniors and people with disabilities. It's designed that way, but in operation, very few of the seniors get the benefit of that deduction. So we have information, AARP does, the National Council on Aging, and we're making a very big push to try to make sure that seniors who pretty commonly have out-of-pocket medical expenses can produce those, the information to the SNAP office, and that can significantly boost the amount of SNAP benefits they get. It's not the only solution, but it would be a near-term one that could make a big difference for a lot of people.
That's really helpful, Ellen. So I want to thank everyone once again for taking the time to join us this afternoon, and I'd really like to thank our panelists, particularly Ellen and Teresa, for joining us today. And a double thanks to the ConAgra Foods Foundation for their support of NCLR and allowing us to do this research and also this webinar and the upcoming briefing. For those of you who participated, feel free to continue this conversation by posting any comments you have on NCLR's Facebook page or on Twitter at NCLR. Have a good afternoon, everyone.